Yeah. Hey. Keeping the weeds out. That is like a full-time job with strawberries the first year, because they haven't really spread enough in order to defend themselves. Boy, does it smell good in here. It smells really, really good. And for very good reason, there are little strawberries. Not big ones, not giant, monster, record-setting, monolithic, gargantuan, you get the idea. Nope, but little strawberries. And the strawberries have been producing all summer long, ever since I planted them. I mentioned the strawberries, I even showed them when I first planted them. They are sending out runners everywhere, all over the place. And my main job is to keep this weeded. And number two, aim the runners where they can start putting down more plants. And there are some stealth weeds in here. Look at this dandelion pretending he's part of the strawberry. You have to be very, very careful to pluck out this dandelion with a root like that right next to your strawberries without disrupting them, if possible. Put soil back over there. Now they're putting out runners. What runners are nothing more than a long stem that comes off the mother plant, and then at the end of it is a little itty bitty plant. And that will hit the ground and put down roots. Yeah, and then you have a brand spanking new plant. Most people do not start strawberries from seeds. They start them from plants, from roots. And then that runner, once it starts rooting, it'll put out another runner. And it goes on and on and on. Meanwhile, the mother is still putting out strawberries, flowers. And this is the end of July, beginning of August period, the mid part of summer, and they're still putting out strawberries all over the place. So I'm very fortunate, but you got to keep these things watered if you want them to keep producing, and you got to keep them weeded. Strawberries do not compete well with weeds when they're young plants. You have to do the work for them. And also, you have to guide these runners to just the right spot. What on earth are you doing, Mr. Worm?
Going for a walk? Got a problem with that?
No, I don't. See, this runner is going to land right next to this plant. I don't want that. I want it a little bit farther over, so I just aim it over this way. And once it sets out roots, you got to wait until they set out roots, because right now it's not going to root. You got to wait, and I'll show you one. Here's one. This runner just set down. I think it was probably yesterday, and now you can see a little root coming off of it. What I like to do is to give them every opportunity. He will put roots down as he sets on the top. What I like to do is just dig a little bit of a hole and then put the soil up just over the stem, but not to cover the plant. That gets the root a little bit farther down and gives it a better start. Keep it moist, and that thing is just going to go nuts. It's going to grow because it has the root that's putting down and sucking up energy to help it. And it's still tied to its mother. Yes, it hasn't left the nest yet. So it has the benefit of its mother to help it out. Strawberries are like that. They're real kind to their children. Just outside the garden, I have my pumpkin plant, right? And she's growing out of a pot, and then she sets her plant down on the ground and winds over here. Well, it's the nature of a pumpkin plant. As they grow along the ground, at certain points, they'll send down roots into the soil because it's such a huge plant and they put out such huge fruit. They couldn't possibly produce all of that with just the energy from the roots from the mother plant. They can't do as well. So the way that your plants will do better is if you let them trail like this and put down roots as they grow. You can vine them up on a trellis, but they don't do as well that way. So as this grew, I noticed it was putting down roots. Everywhere I put down roots, I would go over and grab a shovel full of my compost. Now, I didn't use the good stuff that I'm trying to give to people. I would scoop off the top layer where all the seeds are. You saw that on my compost pile. I take the old dry stuff, I put it in a bucket, I add water, and I turn it into this thick goop. And what I do is wherever I see roots going down into the soil, I heap up some of that compost along there. And right over here is what I'm going to show you. in the way of how I heap the dirt up. I just throw it over the stem. See, so you can see that the stem comes over from the left, right over here, and it's just buried in this. I know that's not probably how a lot of gardeners would do it, but that's how I do it. And that way this big heap will keep it moist, and the roots can go way down in there. And since it's compost, every time I water this, which is daily, the moisture goes through the compost into the soil and feeds the plant. And I have this set up all along here. I got more than one area. I got an area over here too where there's some roots. And along here, there's about five or six areas where there's compost along the vine. So as the vine goes, it gets stronger and stronger. And then towards the end, we've been having male flowers all over the place. You've seen those. And there's the male flower. But right over here, just the other day, look, the lady came to visit and she got pollinated, I believe. Yes, she did. She's wearing her little pollinated hat. Yep. And so we have a pumpkin. These are those pumpkins from the giant pumpkin seeds that a friend, Scott, sent me. He grows record-setting pumpkins and he sent me a few seeds. So I'm going to hopefully get a pumpkin or two from these plants. I have this one and I have a couple other plants growing and they're finally starting to set pumpkins. But like I was mentioning, the rabbits, they love to eat everything. You never know what they're going to eat. And so that's why I have Rascal and the other dogs out here on patrol. And so that's the balance of it. The bunnies have to die sometimes in order for other things to live, because if I let too many bunnies go, they'd eat everything and then everybody would die. So that's just what has to happen. And since these are outside the garden, they're susceptible to rabbits. Now, while I have you in my hands and I'm just maneuvering you all over the place like a camera, I'm going to show you something else. This is where my porch collapsed. Yeah, I'm still working on getting it done. I have to, all these projects cost money, and so I'm saving money as I go, and as I can afford to do things, I'm doing them. Well, while I'm waiting to be able to do my porch, there's dirt here where the steps were and the landing, and look at this. It doesn't look like much. It looked like just a hole. Well, this hole wasn't there a couple weeks ago. This was flat dirt. And what happens is the rabbits come in the evening and they eat dirt. Yes, they do. They eat dirt and they do it for the minerals, and there's something that helps them detoxify or something like that. That's just what rabbits do. So they come up here to my porch in droves and they've been nibbling in one spot. And this spot got to be so deep, a rabbit comes in here and just lays in here in the evening and slowly munches on dirt. Yes, he does. So they're eating the dirt. They're actually eating my land, the rabbits. So yes, I do have to keep them in line. Predators, folks. Even the cute little bunnies, they'll eat everything that you own. Inside the garden, we have things that are eating other things as well. Now, I've mentioned this before, the living soil. Well, here's where the cotton plant is going, and it's got the little cotton bolls right here. So they're doing just fine. Well, what happened was I grew in front of this. I'm growing green onions. You can see the green onions on earlier programs growing here. Well, I planted green onions, and in a row in front of them, I planted radishes. As I harvested the radishes earlier this season, they're long gone now, but as I harvested the radishes, I would pop off the tops and leave them in the garden. Now, this is a tip that I've given you before on if you can't do compost or you don't want to do compost, whatever the reason, there are ways to enrich your soil aside from compost. That is not the only way to do things. There are more than enough ways to do things that can suit every gardener. For instance, what I did was, I showed this one year, and I'm going to show you a time lapse. As I pulled up the radishes, and there were quite a few radishes, I'd pop the tops off, take the radish inside, and eat that. Well, the tops, I could have eaten those, but I don't need those, okay? I got the radish. I'm not being greedy here. I'm feeding something back to the garden. And so give back to the garden will give back to you. Right along here, I put all the radish leaves, and I just piled them on. And what happens is, if you do that in your garden, anything that you pick, like bean plants, tomato plants, lay the leaves and some of the lighter stems on your garden and keep it watered when you water your garden. And what'll happen is the living, breathing soil is going to send up the little armies, and they will digest this food and take it right back into the soil and enrich your soil. Now, what that also does is it's a mulch. and it keeps the soil moist, which is a good thing, especially during the heat of summer. We're in August right now, so we have summer going on, and it keeps the soil from drying out as fast, and it feeds the soil, and it feeds the worms in the soil. It does, and it gets rid of the garden waste. It's a win-win situation. There is no way to look at this as a bad thing. So what happened was, is I put them on here, and I took a picture, one every week. And I want to show you this, okay? Here's a time-lapse, just time-lapse shot of when I put them down, and then 7 days later, then 7 days later, and then 7 days later. Check this out. That's just a beautiful thing to see, isn't it? Right before your very eyes. Now, the mulch part of the mulching aspect of that is very important, especially during the heat of summer in August. It gets really bad around here. Now, at the risk of going back to the tomatoes, they're a great prop, because when I grow tomatoes, the way that I grow them so successfully and beautifully is that first, it's very simple, okay? First, what I do is I plant them deep into my garden so that the roots are way down deep. That way, during the summer when it's hot and dry, the roots get a constant source of moisture, okay? But in the beginning part of the season, they don't have a huge root system. So they're going through a moist, dry cycle because the plant isn't shading the dirt, all right? So it gets a lot of moisture and then it goes dry. A lot of moisture, then it goes dry. That exercises the roots to go down low and strong. Then, as the plant gets big and full, just like this, and in nature, this is how they, in nature, they spread all over the ground. And people don't like to do that. They say, no, you gotta cage up your tomatoes and grow them upright. Think about how a tomato plant is in nature. It's a vine. It's a vine, and it grows in a subtropical area. What it does is it crawls along the ground and it mats and it forms this huge mass of greenery, like cantaloupe vines and all kinds of other vines, like pumpkin and stuff. During the summer, it forms this mat and it shades the ground, right? In nature, and the way that I grow them, all sprawling out. Well, that shade helps keep the moisture from evaporating quite as fast, and it helps suppress weeds with the plant all over the place. So it forms its own protection against weeds and from water loss. And the reason it does that, they're not stupid plants. The reason they do that is that when they're producing fruit, flowers and fruit, they don't want wet, dry, wet, dry. That's only in the beginning when they're getting started out for the root system. When they start producing flowers, no more of that wet, dry. You have to keep them constantly slightly moist, not flooded, not dry, slightly moist constantly. Mulch does that. Well, a tomato is a natural mulcher of its own. But if you have to keep your tomatoes up and stuff, all you have to do is mow your grass or take anything and lay it as a thick layer on here. Grass is perfect because it supplies nitrogen. The worms love it and the soil loves it, and you can just leave it there. Just leave it there all season long. Even after the tomato plant's dead, you cut up the tomato plant, leave it there all winter long, and in the spring, it's barely there, and you can dig it right into the soil, and it helps the soil out. But it is the best thing you can use for mulch. Grass, fresh green grass mowed from your lawn. Don't even let it dry out. Put it on here in a 6-inch layer. It'll mat down as you water it. It'll be the best mulch and fertilizer that you'll ever have naturally and free from your yard. Now, well, the reason that they need the soil moist is because if the soil isn't evenly moist, a tomato plant and pepper plants cannot utilize the calcium that's in the soil. A lot of people will get blossom end rot, and they keep asking me, Ray, what do I do for blossom end rot? I heard that you got to throw lime in there. And a lot of gardeners online are preaching this garbage about crush up some eggshells and throw that in there, throw this in there, add this, add that. No, that's not necessary. And what it is there's usually, almost always, without fail, enough calcium in just about all soil. The reason that they're getting the blossom end rot is because they cannot utilize the calcium that's in the soil. I told an analogy of this on Facebook, and it went over really well. It's kind of like if you sew your mouth shut and somebody shoves pie in your face. You can't eat it because your mouth is sewed shut, okay? You got to unsew your mouth. That's what this is. When it goes from wet, dry, it cannot utilize the calcium in the soil, or if the soil is too alkaline. Like if you throw lime in there, it's going to make it alkaline, which means that the lime in the calcium in the lime can't be utilized. You have to lower the pH, make it more acidic for it to be able to take up the calcium. Here you go. This is wisdom. Take this to the bank, okay? I'll bank my reputation on this. If you have a problem with blossom end rot or you want to avoid it, first thing you do, mulch. Dried grass, dried leaves, wood chips, whatever you want to do, get that mulch in there. That will keep it evenly moist. Second, if you want to make sure that it takes up the calcium, this will not hurt your plant, it will benefit your plant because they like slightly acidic soil. 1 tablespoon of white vinegar per gallon of regular water, mix it up, use that to water your tomato instead of plain water. You can use it indefinitely. What that will do is temporarily, not permanently, temporarily lower the pH just a little bit of your soil so that your plant will be able to uptake the calcium along with the evenly moist soil, which helps it uptake the calcium. It's a win-win situation that is going to pay out in benefits for your tomatoes. Mine don't get blossom end rot. I'm not a genius. I'm not bragging. They don't do it because I know this trick. And I want you to know it as well because that will help you. That's why I wanted to bring the tomato into play. And come here. Come on. I got to do this. You got to pay the price for me talking about calcium. I want to show you something. Now, this is not one of my planting deep, let it go crazy tomato plants. This year, remember, I decided I would opt and stake it and grow it straight up. Well, it is a thick plant because even though it's one plant, it has a center plant, and it has one in the back corner, one in the other corner, one in this corner over here, and one in this corner over here. It's a five-prong plant, so it looks like five plants. And it doesn't produce as much as my other tomatoes did when I let them free range, but the balance of this is the tomatoes are bigger. There are less tomatoes, but they are bigger. And this is Boxcar Willie. An alleged Boxcar Willie, and it's not known for having giant tomatoes. I want to show you something. This right here, from here on over to here, is one giant tomato, and you can tell by looking at the bottom. Yep, it's called a super bloom, and that's when you get these giant flowers that turn into these monstrous tomatoes. That's a super bloom, but that's an anomaly. The other tomatoes on here are about this big, and for a Boxcar Willie, this is considered rather large, and this isn't just one of them. They're all over inside the plant, and they're starting to ripen up just a little bit. They're getting that blush, and it's still growing, and it's still flowering, and not a single one gets blossom end rot. And it's because this is shaded. I don't even have to use mulch in here because the plant shades the ground naturally, and there's a lot of airflow. So you don't see blight. See blight? Nope. No, you don't see blight. That's because it doesn't have blight. And people say that you can't have your plants touching the ground. They're touching the ground back over there. I've never had a problem with blight with growing my plants like this. And that's because I have healthy soil, healthy plants. And that's just how it works. Healthy plants can resist things a lot more. One last thing I want to show you. Actually, the second to the last thing is this. No, this is not a bad tomato plant. These are potatoes. Yes, potatoes. And I wanted to give you a tip on potatoes. When you're growing them, they grow big and strong and tall and beautiful, and they flower, and you're just so proud of them. And then they start looking like this. And then the questions come in, the comments, and people panicking, saying, Ray, my potatoes are dying. They're turning brown. They're falling down. They're looking like they're dead. You know what? You did something right, because that's what your potato plants are supposed to do. They start out strong. They grow big and full. They look just like a tomato plant. They grow huge. And then they slowly start to wither away. The nature of the potato plant is that it will grow strong and green. And as it's growing strong and green, it's putting out roots. And it's putting out roots as fast as it possibly can. And the little rhizomes that are going out. Now, once it starts growing the potatoes and they start getting bigger, the plant starts dying. That's just the nature of the plant. Don't worry about it. Don't go picking off parts of the plant. Don't prune these back. Never prune your potato plants. You don't have to, okay? Now, what you want to do is you want to wait till this plant is stone cold dead. Once everything is yellow and brown and crispy, then your potatoes are ready to dig up. That's how you know it's time to dig your potatoes. I've been asked, Ray, how do I know when it's time to dig my potatoes? When your plants are stone cold dead. That's when you're going to know. Okay, and one last thing. Another shot at the big flower in the room. Yeah. This is bending over the flower, the sunflower, and I'm going to stand on one of the raised beds and show you this because it's a beauty. It got pollinated. It's over a foot across and it's bending down. That thing weighs a freaking ton. But remember, it put out another flower. And look at over here. Yep, little pollinators, little bees on this flower. And that's, if that isn't cute enough, and no, that's not cute enough. Look, underneath it, two more little flowers. So we have a mama over here, and its sister, and two more little sisters. Yes, so the plant that didn't grow as tall as I had expected, it grew more healthy than I ever expected, and it's putting out more flowers than it's supposed to. So yes, that's a beauty. I'm glad I grew it. You guys need more water. You kind of like that, don't you? They're simple creatures. All they need is a little bit of water, a few bugs, and a little attention. Hey, little rooster, how you doing? This one right back here, he's my new friend. He gets out of the coop. And he comes over to me first thing in the morning because he knows I bring him a slice of bread just as a little treat. So he flies outside the coop, runs over, and takes it right out of my hand. Yeah, he's a smart one, he is. He's going to be having problems with Daddy, though. Oh, he's a beauty. One of these days, I'm going to get a close-up shot. His dad is an Americana, okay? He's got the puffy cheeks and stuff. Well, he is a cross between Americana and Silver-Laced Wyandotte, which is a really bizarre look for him, and I can't get him on video right off the bat. But, oh, sure I can. Who am I fooling? Check this out. Yep. You can tell a rooster from a chicken. The rooster's on the right. He's got the droopy tail feathers. The chicken on the left. She has no droopy tail feathers. That's how you tell them apart, folks. And most people turn them into soup. They don't like roosters. I just can't say no to him. He's my little friend. Hey, Lewis. Hey, Lewis. Thanks for joining me today on our garden adventure. If you have any questions concerning anything garden related or animal related, or you just want to say hi, I don't care. I'm always here for you. And if you have any questions, I will give you the best answer I possibly can. And, oh, that feels good. There you go. Okay, I got to get going. I'm just going to sit here and scratch a goat. I don't know what you're going to do. I'm pretty much done. You can go now. Hey. Yeah? Can I touch your ear? Kind of like that? Oh, that feels good.